balik chapter 5. Okay. Hari Selasa lepas kita tak habis lagi on the second and apa lecture. Okay. Cuma hari itu kita sampai slide yang kelima, kita telah derive the equation untuk percentage of our shoot, yang mana kita dapati this is the equation. Okay. Dan selain tu, sebelum tu kita ada equation untuk peak time. Okay. Dan kemudian kita normalisekan the equation of the peak time. Okay. Cuma kalau kita lihat kedua-dua equation ni, the normalized peak time dan juga the percentage of our shoot, basically the equation are only dependent on the damping ratio. Okay. Yang lain tu adalah constant dalam equation ini. Pi is a constant. Okay. Dan daripada that those two equation, okay, kalau kita plotkan the those equation, okay, by varying the damping ratio, apa kita akan dapati? Kita akan dapat the graph for the percentage of our shoot will be decreasing apabila kita when we increase the damping ratio. Okay. And then for normalized peak time, okay, the graph is increasing apabila kita increase the damping ratio. Okay. Jadi daripada sini, what we get that if we wanted the system respond swifter or responding quickly, okay, so what we need to do is that we need to make the peak time low. Okay, because when we talking about the swiftness, the peak time basically controlling the swiftness. Okay, the less the peak time, basically the more swiftness the system is. Okay, and what we found out that the damping ratio also should be low. And because the damping ratio is lower, okay, what will happen is that the percentage of overshoot will be higher. Okay. Okay. So when we talk about the peak time, basically the system is good, but when we talk about the percentage of overshoot, because when the percentage of overshoot is higher, basically the system will become not good. Okay, so there is a contradiction issue there. Okay, on the other hand, okay, if we want the system respond so that it is closer to the final value, okay, so we'll be concerning about the percentage of our shoot. Okay. We should select as much as possible so that the percentage of our shoot is lower. Okay. And then from this graph, we find out that when the percentage of our shoot is lower, the damping ratio is high. Okay. The damping ratio is high. Okay, and when the damping ratio is high, okay, what will happen? The peak time will be higher, will be increasing. Okay? So in terms of the closeness to final value, basically, this one will be good, but at the end, the system will become slower because the peak time is increasing. Okay? So this is good, this is bad. Okay? So that's why this thing is always contradicting each other. Okay? So that's why in this case, we need to find the optimum. Okay? So that in these two terms, between the system response in terms of swiftness and also in terms of closer to final value, we should trade off. Okay? So, since we need to trade off, okay, so that both of them is not become bad, the main thing. Okay? So, the best selection for the damping ratio is actually at the point where the intersection between that graph. Okay? That is actually the optimum value for the damping ratio. Okay? So, if we have the damping value of the damping ratio at this value, we select at this intersection, basically we will have our percentage of our shoot is maybe around 24%. Okay? So I think they, 24% may be acceptable. Okay? And if you look at your normalized peak time, you will get something around 3.5 lah. Okay? Almost 3.5. Okay? That is your normalized peak time. Okay? So compared to this one, is basically you can imagine if you get this value, it is around 4.4. Okay? So basically you have a lot of difference here. Okay? So that is the optimum value. So normally if this happens, we need to find the optimal value like this. Okay, one more measurement performance that we haven't discussed is about the race time. Okay. Maybe I need to, if you forget what is the race time is, maybe we need to go back to the initial. Okay, when we talk about the race time, okay, when we talk about the race time, okay, basically the time when the first time the output will equal to the final value, and that is the time that is taken. Okay? The only thing, if you have a system which is overdamped, it won't cross the final value. So we just consider between 10% to 90%, TR1. Okay? So that's basically the time that we need to measure. Okay? If you can plot this graph, basically you can measure from here. Okay? But otherwise, if you need, if you don't have the graph, you need to use the equation. So let's see how we derive the equation. Okay. Okay, actually for race time, okay, since it is quite difficult to calculate to come up to derive the equation, okay, what we can do is that we can do some experiment, okay, so that we can plot the TR1, okay, we can plot the TR1, okay, where in this case we normalize, so we multiply with the natural frequency, okay, we plot it versus the damping ratio, okay, so basically we vary the damping ratio and then get the value of omega n multiplied by TR1, okay, when we plotted the graph, okay, we can get from that, okay, and then from that basically if for each point of the damping ratio we plot the graph and we will get some sort of curve like this after plotting the graph from the experiment, okay, so it's always a curve like this, okay, and if you look at this curve, probably this curve is basically the data normally we plotted from around 0.05 until 0.95, okay, for the value of the damping ratio, okay. Okay, the only thing to make us easier, so basically if we can get the equation representing this curve, basically we can use that equation to calculate the value of the damping, value of the TR1, the rest time, okay, so the only thing to make the equation much simpler, instead of finding the equation for this curve, what you can do is that you can draw a line which is, for example, if we have this curve, maybe the midpoint is somewhere around here, okay, and then around that point just we draw a linear line, okay, and we just draw a line so that, okay, this line can approximate this curve, okay, so in this case of course we know that if we go if we draw the line, extend the line until 0.95, for example, the error will be bigger, so in this case if we consider just around 0.3 until 0.8, okay, maybe the error is acceptable, okay, so we just draw a line like that, and basically with this line, okay, if you extend this line until it's crossing the y-axis here, okay, you will find that it will be crossing somewhere around 0.6, okay, it will be crossing somewhere on 0.6, because this is 1, so it go down a little bit more, so I think if you draw that, it will get 0.6, and if you find the slope of this line, okay, because here we know the value is what, okay, here we know the value is what, so interpolating that line, basically we know that the slope is equal to 2.16, okay, so if we write like this, 2.16, the slope multiplied by zeta plus, this is the C, okay, that is basically the equation for a line, right, okay, so that is the equation for this line, okay, and this equation is basically equal to TR1 multiplied by omega n, okay? And then the only thing, the omega n, instead of on the right-hand side, we just bring to the right-hand side, which become the division of omega n here. Okay, so basically we got the equation of the R1. Okay? So this is the equation of the raise time from 10% to 90%. Okay? Which is 2.16 multiplied by zeta plus 0.6 divided by omega n. Okay? So you can use this equation for calculating the raise time. Okay, we do the formula for TR1 because TR1 basically can be used for underdam and can be used also for overdam system. Okay. So basically, from this equation, the raise time value can be obtained by using linear approximation method. The only thing, this one is applicable only for the damping ratio ranging between 0.3 to 0.8. Okay. So you can memorize this equation. Okay, next we look more into the swiftness. Okay, swiftness depends on damping ratio and natural frequency. Okay, when we talk about the swiftness, okay, because for example, just now the swiftness is, one is the rest time, the other one is the peak time. Okay, both of these performance measure, basically the equation if you look, okay, there is natural frequency and also damping ratio. Okay, whereas like performance of overshoot, just now when we see the equation is only depend on damping ratio, not the natural frequency. Okay. So for example, if you have a system, okay, let's say you set the natural frequency equal to 5 radian per second. Okay, you fix the natural frequency. And if you vary the damping ratio, for example, when the damping ratio is equal to 1, you will have a critical damp response like this, okay, no overshoot, okay. But after that, when you change the damping ratio, you lower the damping ratio from 1 to 0.7, okay, what will happen when you plot it, the response, you find that there will be overshoot because the system become underdamped, okay, so there will be overshoot, okay, and if you consider about the swiftness, for example, if you measure the raise time, okay, for damping ratio equal to 1, the raise time is here, okay, somewhere around 1.4 second, I think. Okay? But when you reduce the damping ratio to 0.7, okay, the raise time will be somewhere 0.7, I think. Okay? So basically, it shows that when you vary the damping ratio, basically the swiftness will be changing. Okay? If you reduce the damping ratio, the swiftness will become faster. Okay? And also here, now if you set the damping ratio constant, and then you vary the natural frequency. Let's say if we set the natural frequency equal to 1 radian per second, we have a response like this. Okay? And then when we change the natural frequency instead of 1 radian per second, we change it to 10 radian per second, what will happen? The response will become like this. Okay? From this graph, if you look at it, okay, the peak of the overshoot is the same. Right? Okay? Because why? Because the overshoot is only dependent on the damping ratio. If you change the damping ratio, it will change. Okay? But when you change only the natural frequency, but you make the damping ratio constant, the percent of overshoot will be the same. Okay? But here, it's only the natural frequency is changing. Okay? With this response, when we set omega n equal to 10, the frequency is much faster like this. Okay? Whereas this one is lower. Okay? And when we talk about the swiftness, okay, let's look of one of the parameter measure is the race time. Okay? For this one, the race time is maybe around 1.7 maybe. Okay? But for this one, the race time is equal to what? It's around 0.3 maybe, 0.3 second. Okay? So that means if you increase the frequency, okay, the system will respond faster. Okay? So this is the effect of the natural frequency change. Okay, so that's why natural frequency and also damping ratio is very important when we talk about the swiftness. Okay, whereas the overshoot does not depend on natural frequency. Okay, the overshoot is only depending on the damping ratio. Okay, you have seen also in the equation of damping ratio is only the equation of the percentage of overshoot, okay, only damping ratio is available in the equation. Okay? Okay, however, the swiftness is limited by percentage of overshoot that can be accepted. Okay? In this case also, when we are playing with the frequency, for example, although we can make the system to be faster, however, we need to also play with the damping ratio so that the percentage of overshoot, normally we should try to make it lower. Okay, maybe if we have around 1.2 or 20%, I think that's the best response that we will have. Okay, so as summary, what you have learned, the definition of the standard performance measurements and the second order system response to a unit step input. Okay, basically the performance measure is depend on second order response to a unit step input. That is the basis. Okay. And you have learned the derivation also of the equation, okay, for settling time, for the peak time, for the overshoot, and also the race time. Okay? Maybe I should recall also that the performance measure that we have done, there are 5 of them, right? Okay? 3 is talking about the closeness to the final value, and 2 is talking about the swiftness. Okay? So for the, when we talk about the closeness to the final value, there is overshoot, percentage of overshoot, what else? The steady state error, and settling time. Okay, so these three are based on the closeness to the final value. When we talk about the swiftness, okay, two measurements. One is the race time, and the other one is the peak time. Okay. Okay, the contradiction of the peak time and also percent of overshoot plot. Okay, we have shown this. Okay, basically when we talk about the swiftness and also closeness to the final value, okay, this both criteria will contradict to each other, and we need to compromise. Okay, we need to get a trade-off, the optimum. The optimum selection of the damping ratio. Okay, swiftness depend on damping ratio, natural frequency, whereas percent of overshoot does not depend on natural frequency. Okay, you have shown you have seen from the plot of the response when you vary either the natural frequency or you vary the damping ratio. Okay, so what you have learned will become a foundation for analyzing the performance of control system. So any question on this before I, yes? Tak, normalize peak time is basically peak time kita kalikan dengan natural frequency. Okay, itu je. Sebab macam tadi kita buat tu semata-mata untuk kita eliminate the natural frequency in the equation. Macam mana? You talking about yang mana, yang ni ke yang you talking about sini? Aha. Tak, dia sebenarnya macam ni, dia just nak generalizekan this plot sebab bila dia normalizekan, dia kalikan dengan omega n di sini. Okey. Maksudnya this plot boleh digunakan untuk any system yang mempunyai different value of omega n. Faham tak? For generalizing lah. Okay. Macam mana? Tak, kalau you tengok you punya the equation, okay, kalau you tengok the equation of the peak time, okay, sebab they are peak time is basically is categorized as the swiftness. Jadi memang dia akan depending on the damping ratio dan juga the natural frequency. Betul tak? Okay. Cuma tadi sebab kita nak compare yang ni dengan ini. Jadi sebab cuma equation ini dia tak ada natural frequency. Faham tak? Okey. Dan kalau kita plot yang ini dengan plot yang ini, maksudnya untuk kita comparing memang tak samalah. Jadi what we do, we just bawa omega n ke sini, jadi the equation ni akan jadi just depend on damping ratio. Okey. Jadi yang ini pun just depend on damping ratio, jadi kita boleh compare together. Kan? Cuma bila kita ada equation macam ini, okay, this equation akan valid untuk any system yang mempunyai omega n tertentu, natural frequency yang tertentu. Cuma bila kita tahu dia punya omega n, value ni nanti kita bagikan dengan this omega n, kita dapatlah dia punya peak time. Itu saja. Okay, ada lagi soalan? Okay, kalau tak ada, kita pergi the next slide. Lecture 3. Okay, the next slide is basically we will talk about the effect of roots on system response. Okay. Sebab selama ni kita bercakap tentang sistem yang first order yang ada satu pole saja, dan kemudian kita bercakap tentang sistem yang second order, okey, yang ada dua pole, okey. Cuma yang first order kita tahu dia punya pole akan senantiasa real, okey. Yang ada dua pole ni, yang second order, the pole can be real dan can be complex, bergantung kepada nilai damping ratio dan juga omega n. Okay. Tapi bagaimana kalau kita ada sistem yang higher order daripada ini, third order, fourth order dan sebagainya? Okay. Jadi I will explain the effect of roots on their location in S-plane on the second order system. Okay, what you will learn is that you will learn the effect of the third pole and a zero on second order system respond. Okay, bila kita kata roots tu, the roots can be pole dan can be zero. Okay, third pole ni kenapa kita kata third pole? Sebab tadi kalau kita dah ada second order system, dia dah ada dua pole. Okay, let's say kita tambahkan satu pole lagi, dia akan jadi third order, kan? Betul tak? Okay, tapi beside the pole, kita boleh juga ada tambahan dekat zero. Okay, tambahan root dekat zero. Okay, dan itu pun kita kena lihat apa akan terjadi. Okay, next kita akan juga lihat tentang the S-plane root location and the transient response. Okay, so your knowledge in chapter 1, chapter 2 and chapter 4 will help you understanding this. Okay, let's look this transfer function. Okay, if you have this transfer function, nampak tak kecil sangat dah? Okay, if you have this transfer function, nampak? This is a second order equation, kan? Okay, S square plus 2 multiplied by zeta multiplied by S plus 1. Okay. Cuma di sini sebenarnya omega n adalah sama dengan 1. Okay, ini sepatutnya omega n square. Dan ini juga omega n square. Okay. Cuma omega n kita set kepada 1. Jadi equation of the second order dia hanya jadi macam ni saja. S square plus 2 zeta multiplied by S plus 1. Okay. So, bila kita ada the second order equation, apa jadi? Okay. Dengan omega n is equal to 1. Okay. Jadi, the poles ni, for the second order equation, can be real and it can be also complex. Dora. So if the if they are complex, apa jadi? They mungkin located satu kat sini, mungkin satu located kat sini. Okay? Sebab omega n adalah equal to 1. This is omega n square. Okay? Sama dengan 1. Jadi this distance daripada origin ke this roots akan sama dengan 1. Sama dengan omega n. Betul tak? Okay? And then the distance dari sini sampai sini, okay, adalah sama dengan negative zeta kali omega n. Okay? Cuma the only thing omega n adalah sama dengan 1, sebab tu tinggal negative zeta. Okay? Jadi maksudnya the value of yang depending on the value of the zeta ni, yang mana the roots ni can be dekat arc ni. Okay? Kalau dia the zeta is less than 1, yang mana dia akan berada dekat sini. Okay? Bila zeta sama dengan 1, dia akan berada dekat sini. Kalau zeta is larger than 1, 1 akan berada dekat sini. 1 akan berada dekat sini. Dia akan jadi real roots. Okay? Okay, itu untuk the second order equation yang ada kat sini. Okay? Kalau kita lihat di sini, kita ada tambahan the third pole. Nampak? Ini adalah gamma multiply by S plus 1. Okay? Maksudnya kalau kita equate ni sama dengan kosong, okay, S akan jadi equal to negative 1 over gamma. Okay? So that is the location of the third pole. Okay? Okay? Jadi this is the location of the third pole. Jadi location ini pun dia akan bergantung pada value gamma. Kan? Kalau katakan value gamma adalah besar, basically dia mungkin akan berhampiran dengan origin. Okay? Kalau value gamma adalah kecil, yang mana dia akan mungkin berada jauh daripada origin. Okay? Okay? Cuma hari itu saya ada sentuh, masa kita discuss tentang Scilab, saya ada sentuh tentang dominant. Ingat lagi tak? Okay? Yang mana saya kata apabila the poles itu dia berada lebih hampir kepada imaginary axis, yang mana dia akan jadi lebih dominant. Betul tak? Okay? Dan kalau katakan position, let's say the position of the complex pole adalah di sini. Okay? Dan the position of the third pole dekat sini. Okay? Maksudnya yang ini lebih jauh daripada daripada the complex pole. Kalau kita bandingkan dengan imaginary axis. Okay? Kalau yang ini lebih jauh. Okay? Mana satu yang akan lebih dominan? Mana? Complex pole ke the third pole? Complex pole akan lebih dominan kan? Okay, sebab yang mana dia terdekat dengan imaginary axis, dia akan lebih dominan. Bila dia lebih dominan, the plot of the response lebih kurang macam mana? Jadi dia akan ikut the complex pole punya respon lah. Okay? Sebab complex pole punya respon, okay, because dia ada imaginary part, dia ada oscillation kan? Okay? Jadi kita akan expecting yang mana ada overshoot dan sebagainya lah. Okay, the response akan fluctuating. Tapi kalau katakan yang ini dia berada di dekat sini contohnya, di hadapan daripada ni, apa akan jadi? Mana akan lebih dominan? Okay, the third pole akan jadi lebih dominan. Dan bila the third pole akan jadi lebih dominan, how you going to see the response? Okay, the response akan hasilkan satu respon yang over them. Okay, sebab bila yang ini, sebab dia hanya real. Okay, sebab dia hanya real, yang mana dia tak ada imaginary part, yang mana dia tak ada fluctuation. Okay, jadi dia punya respon adalah over them. Okay, disebabkan dia dominan. Okay. Okay. Jadi that is the point. Okay. Dan kita boleh lihat benda ni. If you want, you boleh simulate. Okay. You boleh gunakan ada MATLAB ataupun SciLab. Okay. Let's say mungkin dalam equation ni, okay, mungkin you set the zeta kepada 0.45. Okay. Bila zeta equal to 0.45, maksudnya equation yang second order ni dia akan hasilkan complex pole, kan? Jadi pole dia akan berada macam tu. Okay, cuma yang ini akan equal to negative, the location ni sama dengan negative 0.45. Okay, dan sekarang ni apa kita buat? Kita ubah kedudukan ni. Kita ubah nilai gamma, kedudukan of the third pole. Okay. Kalau kita set gamma kepada 2.25, maksudnya 1 divided by gamma adalah sama dengan 0.44. Bila 0.44, kalau you tengok, yang ini adalah 0.45. Very close. Maksudnya dia sama dekat sini. Okey, kedudukan ini, kedudukan third pole ni somewhere dekat sini. Okey. Dan kalau gamma 1.5, kita akan dapat the ratio yang ini tadi sama dengan ini. Ini mungkin somewhere dekat sini. Okey. Dan bila yang ini, basically after this, dia akan jadi lebih jauh, lebih jauh, lebih jauh. Dan bila kita set gamma kepada kosong, basically dia akan jadi infinity. Kedudukannya jauh betul-betul dari pada origin. Okay. Dan kita ubah the value of the gamma. Okay. Dan setiap kali kita set gamma kepada satu value tertentu, kita boleh run this is equation ni. Kita boleh simulatekan dengan SciLab. Okay. Dan kita dapat the response tu, kita plot dia, kita measure dia punya PO, measure dia punya settling time. Okay. Cuma in this case kita boleh kalikan dengan dia punya natural frequency which is equal to 1. Okay. Untuk kita normalizekan of the settling time. Okay. Dan kita akan dapat value yang berbeza bagi PO dan juga settling time apabila kita vary the kedudukan of the third pole. Okay. So ini adalah the results daripada the third order system yang ada sini. Maksudnya dua complex pole dan juga the third pole di sini digabungkan. Okay. Tapi let's say kalau kita consider the system ni second order, maksudnya the third pole ni tak ada. Okey. Kita boleh gunakan equation yang kita pelajari sebelum ni. PO adalah sama dengan this equation. Okey. Cuma be careful, equation ni sebenarnya hanya apply untuk second order system saja. Okey. Kalau ada third order system macam ni, sebenarnya kita tak boleh pakai equation ni. Tapi kalau kita andaikanlah kita the third pole ni tak ada, jadi the system akan jadi second order kan. Jadi kalau dia sistem jadi second order dan kita gunakan an equation ini, kita masukkan value omega n, masukkan value zeta di sini, kita akan dapati the PO is around 20.5%. Okay. Whereas the settling time, kita akan dapati dia sama dengan 8.9. Okay. Kalau you calculate the normalized settling time pun, sebab omega n sama dengan 1, basically pun sama dengan 8.9. Okay. Cuma kalau kita tengok dengan value ini tadi, kalau kita lihat dari segi PO, maksudnya for the second order, okay, dia punya PO ni sama dengan apabila kita ada third pole, yang mana third pole ni located dekat sini, ataupun third pole ni located jauh dekat infinity. Nampak? 20.5, 20.5. Okey. Dan yang ini pula kalau kita lihat 8.9, 8.9 is somewhere dekat sini, in between sini. Okey. Mungkin hampir, mungkin dalam lingkungan 12. Itulah. Okey. Ataupun mungkin 11 point something. Bukan. Sini. Around, mungkin around, dalam around 1 lah. Okey. Kedudukan dia. Okey. Okey. Jadi bila kita lihat yang ni, maksudnya sekarang ni, apabila kita tambahkan third pole, apa jadi? Nampak tak? Bila kita tambahkan third pole ni, dan kalau kita letakkan third pole ni, kedudukan dia dekat sini, yang mana ini dekat sini, third pole kita letak kat sini, kan? Nampak PO tadi daripada yang second order tadi 20.5%, sekarang ni dia jadi kosong. Dia akan menghilangkan. Kan? Okey, dan yang ini mungkin kedudukan dia kat sini. Kalau kedudukan dekat sini, dia akan kurangkan sikit. Dan kalau kedudukan kat sini makin jauh ni, mungkin around 20, bila around 20, yang mana kita akan dapati dia punya PO lebih kurang sama dengan the PO untuk second order system. Okey. Jadi kalau you lihat sini, you akan nampak bahawa jika third pole ini berada jauh, kita compare dengan kedudukan of the second of the complex pole, okey, yang mana kesan dia akan jadi kurang, betul tak? Sebab tu dia punya percentage of overshoot tak berubah, okey, sebab dia dah kurang memberi kesan. Tapi apabila dia berhampir, makin hampir kepada yang ni, apa akan jadi? Dia akan mengubah the respon. Sebab tu percentage of overshoot akan bertambah kecil. Okey, sebab kita tahu yang third pole ni, sebab dia first order. Dan bila dia first order, basically dia tak akan ada overshoot. Sebab tu dia akan tend untuk kurangkan the percentage of overshoot. Kan, bila kita dekatkan dia. Okey. Unless nanti bila kita letakkan dia lebih ke depan daripada complex pole ni, yang mana kita akan dapati dia akan jadi dominating pula. Kan, yang mana the PO memang akan absolutely hilanglah. Dan in fact, the response akan follow the response of the third pole. Okay. Dan kalau kita lihat of the settling time pun sebenarnya lebih kurang begitu juga. Cuma nampak kita nampak macam ni dia tak macam tak konsisten tak ni lagi lah. Masih berkurangan lagi. Dan tapi sebenarnya makin jauh dia daripada sini sebenarnya dia punya kesan pun makin berkurangan. Okey. Jadi kita boleh katakan di sini if the kedudukan of the third pole jauh daripada kedudukan of the complex pole, zeta multiplied by omega n ni adalah kedudukan of the complex pole. Okay, kita boleh katakan the effect of the third pole is less and can be neglected. Okay, dan berapa jauhnya? I think some researcher dia suggest dia letakkan 10 kali ganda. Maksudnya kalau the distance dari sini ke sini, kalau kita compare dengan distance ini ke sini, kalau katakan yang ini ke sini adalah 10 kali ganda daripada distance ini, kita boleh anggapkan yang ini dia dah tak ada kesan kepada responnya. Okay? Maksudnya kalau kita ada percentage of overshoot, percentage of overshoot dia akan sama dengan percentage of overshoot of second order system. Maksudnya kita dah boleh gunakan formula ni untuk estimate. Okey. Maksudnya kalau kedudukan yang ini adalah jauh daripada imaginary axis, yang mana kita boleh neglect this pole dan kita anggap dia just sebagai second order system, dan kita boleh gunakan equation ini untuk estimate the performance. Okay, jelas lah. Ada soalan tak sini? Okay. Tadi kita bercakap tentang poles. Okay. Di sini kita ada transfer function. Okay, sama juga kita ada second order system di sini. Kita ada dua poles yang mana boleh jadi poles yang kompleks ataupun reals. Tetapi kalau kita lihat di sini kita ada tambahan of zero. Okay. Kita tambah root tapi di sebelah atas. Yang kita panggil zero. Okay. Kita pun nak tengok sama ada kalau kita ada tambahan of zero kat atas ni, sama ada ia juga akan affecting the respon ke tidak. Okay. Sama juga di sini, apa kita buat? Kita simulatekan menggunakan Scilab. Okay, daripada equation ni mungkin kita boleh set zeta kepada value tertentu. Let's say kalau kita set zeta kepada 0.1. Okay. And then kita set satu value untuk A dan juga zeta omega n. Bila kita ambil ratio ini, ini maksudnya ratio antara kedudukan of the zero kepada complex pole. Okay. A is kedudukan zero. Zeta omega n is basically kedudukan of the complex pole. Okay. Bila kita letakkan the ratio sama dengan 1, basically kedudukan of the zero dan juga complex pole adalah sama. Okay. Okay, kalau kita letak contohnya 0.1, basically the bila kita letakkan 0.1, maksudnya yang apa ni zero adalah berhampiran dengan imaginary axis. Okey, kalau kita letakkan 10, basically the zero adalah lebih jauh daripada imaginary axis. Okey. Dan bila kita plotkan, kita akan dapat satu plot serupa seperti ini. Okey, dan kita boleh vary zeta. Okey, yang mana kita akan dapat semua plot-plot macam ini, yang mana ini plot berkaitan dengan this ratio dengan percent of overshoot. Data dari sini menunjukkan bahawa the percentage of overshoot adalah affected dengan ratio ini. Okey, maksudnya the percentage of overshoot affected, sebab macam ni kan, dia kalau tak affected mesti dia akan jadi horizontal line. Okey, tapi sebab dia jadi slope macam ni, maksudnya dia adalah affected dengan kedudukan of the zero. Okey. Sini pun sama, kita boleh try dengan the value zeta equal to 4.5. Okey. Dan mungkin omega n pun kita boleh set kepada 1. Okey. Dan kalau kita vary benda ni dan kita buat measurement, kita akan dapat macam ni. Okey. Nampak apabila the ratio is small, 0.5 ni maksudnya the zero adalah lebih hampir kepada imaginary axis berbanding dengan the complex pole. Jadi kita akan dapat the PO akan increase very much. Kan? Tapi kalau kita letakkan dia jauh daripada imaginary axis, contohnya 5 kali kalau kita bandingkan dengan complex poles, yang mana kita akan dapat dia punya PO juga akan reducing. Jadi ini pun menunjukkan yang mana kedudukan zero juga akan effect the response. Okay. Seperti tadi, kalau kita based on second order system, kalau kita anggap zero ni tak ada, dia akan jadi second order system. Okey, yang mana PO sepatutnya 20.5% saja. Okey. Dan the race time, the settling time 8.9 dan the peak time is around 3.5. Jadi you boleh compare the value di situ. Okey, yang mana dia tak sama. Okey, maksudnya dia affected. Dan kalau you plot the response pun, you akan dapati dengan ratio yang berbeza ini, okey, you akan dapati respon dia memang berbeza. Okey. Jadi maksudnya bila you tambahkan zero ni, dia akan affect the system. Okey, the zero also affect the response, especially when it is near to the complex pole. Seperti ini kan, bila near, sama ada 0.5 ataupun 2 ni, kita consider near lah. Yang mana dia akan effect banyak. Okey, sebab kalau kita bandingkan, ini sepatutnya 20 saja. Okey, tapi because they are near, jadi dia akan increase the PO a lot. Okey. Jadi, this is the zero. Jadi, basically, the zero sebenarnya dia juga akan memberi kesan. Okey. Cuma how much the kesan tu, tapi compare dengan the poles tadi, kalau kita ada third poles, the third pole dia boleh memberi kesan. Okey. Tetapi kalau dia terlampau jauh tu, kita boleh neglect the kesan daripada third pole. Okey, tapi for the zero ni, kita kadang-kadang kita tak boleh nak neglect. Sebab kalau kita tengok di sini pun, bila kita letakkan dia jauh pun, dia masih affecting juga. Okey. Walaupun telah berkurangan. Okey. Jadi kita tak boleh abaikan. Cuma hari itu bila kita bincang tentang dengan satellite, bila kita tambahkan poles, tambahkan zero ni, satu kemungkinan dia boleh cancel out dengan pole yang ada di bawah kalau dia exactly sama. Okey. Jadi bila dia cancel out dengan pole yang ada di bawah, jadi basically dia akan mengurangkan menghilangkan kesan pole tersebut. Itu saja. Okey. Nak kita habiskan ni ke ataupun nak sambung semester depan selepas cuti? Saya ada satu slide je, boleh habiskan sebab saya takut lupa ni. Dua slide rasanya. Allah, ada slide banyak lagi. Okey, cuma nanti boleh ingatkan saya, kita berhenti di sini. Okey.